Good afternoon and welcome to this Globe Church service. My name's Jonty. It's a great joy to be able to welcome you and to have you with us as we share this time together. Our plan this afternoon is slightly different. We're going to try and do things slightly differently. We're going to turn the service the other way around to how we normally do it. We're going to start by praying, reading the Bible and hearing God's word to us. And then in the second part of our time together, we'll have a chance to respond and to hear some reflections on what we've heard and to think about it and to respond in song. And we wonder if that would just help us as a church family to make the most of our time together this afternoon. But we're going to pray as we start our time. Why don't we bow our heads and let's ask that God would be with us as we spend this time together. Oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Heavenly Father, we thank you that in this world you have not changed, that you have not lost the plot, that you are still on the throne. Father, our confidence is that you are a great, unsearchably wonderful God. And so we humble ourselves before you this afternoon. And we ask that you would help us. Lord, please would you speak to us. Father, please would you meet with us wherever we are as we're scattered all over the place. Might we know your presence with us. Might we hear your voice and respond to you in faith and worship. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to think for the next few weeks about how do you get on with life? You know, everything has changed around us, but you can't just press pause and sort of wait for it all to get back to normal and for this to blow over. Yeah, everything has changed. We now walk down the street and there's a whole load of angst that we never had before when we see someone coming towards us. Some of us, our circumstances have changed dramatically. Some of us are far more busy. Some of us are less busy. Some of us are living in isolation. Some of us maybe wish we were. Some of us are still in London. Some of us have moved elsewhere. So much has changed, but we've got to get on with life. We've got to get on with living and following Jesus. We've got to get on with understanding what it means to live in this world. Now, as we've spent time in the last few weeks, a lot of our focus has been on the future. Both in Globe Daily and in our Sunday services, we've thought very much about the future hope that we have as Christians. That's been useful for us. It's reminded us that this world is not our home and that the struggles of this world are temporary and are not worth comparing with the glory that's coming. But we've got to get on with life today. What about today? How do we live today? Well, Paul, the man who wrote Romans, was very practical. And he teaches us important things about living today. Being a Christian is not about sitting around waiting for heaven to arrive with our heads in the clouds. No, there's things to be getting on with. It means living now. And Romans chapter 12 is a chapter of the Bible full of practical help for us. And that's what we're going to explore in the coming weeks. Romans 12 and maybe 13 and 14 and explore lots of different themes about what we should be doing now as Christians. We're going to focus today on verses 1 and 2. So I'd love you to turn there and perhaps have that open as I read that. Let's hear God's word to us and then we'll think together about how this helps us to live. So Paul writes in Romans 12, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." These two verses form the pivot point in this book of Romans. they set up all of the practical things that Paul is going to teach us. We're going to learn about hospitality and serving one another and praying and how you deal with people that are difficult. All sorts of practical things, how you relate to governments. But all of them rest on what he says in these two verses. So we need to take a good look at these and have a good think about what they're teaching. Now let's just have a look at how the verses work to start with. Just see the structure of these two verses. There are two commands in these verses. In verse 1, there is the command to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. There's command 1. And then in verse 2, you get command number 2, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So offer your bodies and be transformed. They're the two commands. But those two commands rest upon a foundation. They are rooted in a fundamental reality. And that is, at the start of verse 1, in view of God's mercy. You see, it is the mercy of God which is the foundation for obedience to these commands. It is extremely important for us as Christians that we must not hear God's commands without first hearing God's motivation. Obedience that does not flow out of an experience of God's mercy is not Christian obedience. It may be religious, but it's not Christian. No, it is the mercy of God which is the engine and the motivation behind all Christian obedience. Therefore, the mercy of God is fundamental to everything. And if the mercy of God becomes mundane to us, then obedience will become a chore. So you ask what we should be getting on with in these days? Well, here's the first thing we should be getting on with: treasuring the mercy of God. The more we can see of the majesty of God's mercy, the more we will be motivated to obey him with the whole of our lives. So Romans chapter 12 starts with this word, therefore. And don't be fooled by that word. Hidden under that word is all that Paul has said in chapters 1 to 11. Paul has carefully and painstakingly explained to us the mercy of God, and he says, therefore, now live these commands. So let's take a moment to enjoy God's mercy. I'm going to go very fast, and I'm going to pick out some highlights from Romans chapters 1 to 11 of the mercy of God, and I want to encourage you to enjoy this. As I speak and as I show you what God's word says, why not be worshiping in your heart? Turn these things into praise. You can do it out loud if you want, but at least in your heart be saying, yes, yes. Now look, it may be that you're watching this and you're not a Christian. It's great that you've joined this afternoon. And let me encourage you to listen hard. This is the mercy of God. This is the foundation of what it means to be a Christian. And hey, who knows? Even this afternoon, you might have a life-changing encounter with the mercy of God. So are you ready? You want to know about mercy? Well, let me give you a little taste. But it will only be a little taste, because the mercy of God is unsearchably deep and unfathomably rich. You see, God is mercy. He does not just possess mercy. He is not just merciful sometimes. He is mercy. He is always merciful. It flows from the very essence of who God is. It flows from his very heart. God doesn't need a counselor or an advisor to tell him to be merciful. Hey, why don't you try this? He is mercy. Even in the face of intense provocation, God is merciful. And God looks at this world that he has made, and he looks at the people who bear his image. And you know what he sees? He sees godlessness and wickedness. He sees people who suppress the truth about God by their wickedness. He sees people who have exchanged the truth about God for a lie. He sees people who have chosen to worship created things rather than the Creator who is forever praised. And as God looks at this world that has rejected him, he is rightly and deeply angry. Our world hangs under the wrath of God. It is a desperate and dangerous situation. But remember, he's the God of mercy. And so God sees this world with eyes of mercy. He sees more. And he sees the desperate need. Yes, we are guilty, but we're also powerless. We can't keep God's law. We can't save ourselves. We can't achieve the standard. We cannot escape God's wrath. And so the mercy of God looked at us in our powerless state, and he has acted on our behalf. It is God's mercy that drove him to send his son into the world. It is the mercy of God that offered Jesus as a sacrifice of atonement on the cross. It is the mercy of God that freely offers forgiveness to all who will receive it by faith. It is the mercy of God by which guilty people are freely justified. It is the mercy of God that means we are fully and completely forgiven, that it has all been done, that Jesus was punished in our place that we might go free. It is the mercy of God. That's the mercy that Paul says we are to have in view. That is the foundation, but we're not finished yet. In fact, we're just getting started on the mercy of God. It is the mercy of God that means we now have access into this grace in which we now stand. It is the mercy of God that loved us while we were still sinners. It is the mercy of God that saw us in our powerless and feeble position and made the choice to save us. It is the mercy of God that guarantees our future. It is the mercy of God that means that through Christ, righteousness overflows to many. It is the mercy of God that means Christ stands as our representative. He fights for us. It's the mercy of God that means now grace reigns through righteousness. It is the mercy of God that means we have been set free from slavery to sin and can now offer ourselves to him. It is the mercy of God that means we are not paid the wages that our sin deserves, that is death, but instead we are given eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. It is the mercy of God that comes to us in our struggle and our battle. It is the mercy of God that means when we cry out, "Who will deliver me from this body of death?" there is an answer that says, "Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord." It is the mercy of God that means there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. It's the mercy of God that means the righteous requirements of the law have been fully met in Christ. It's the mercy of God that means we are now adopted as God's sons and daughters, and by his Spirit we now cry out, "Abba, Father." It's the mercy of God that as we groan in prayer, the Spirit groans with us. It is the mercy of God that means one day we will be set free from bondage to decay. It's the mercy of God that means we are more than conquerors in Christ. It's the mercy of God that chose us, that loved us, that preached to us, that found us. It's the mercy of God that grafted us into his people. And it's the mercy of God that guarantees not one of God's people will be lost. Oh, how great and unsearchable are the riches of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Therefore, in view of God's mercy. Do you feel it? Do you feel the weight, the majesty, the breadth? We've only scratched the surface. Oh, the mercy of God. When God's mercy becomes mundane, obedience becomes a chore. But when God's mercy sparkles in its infinite majesty, obedience becomes a joy. Here is the foundation upon which we offer our bodies as living sacrifices. Here is the motivation that transforms us. We don't obey God out of fear, because otherwise he might punish punish us. We don't obey God out of guilt, trying to pay him back for all he's done to us, trying to make up for our sins. We obey him because of his mercy. Christians are compelled by an overwhelming sense of the mercy of God. It is God's mercy who has made us who we are. You know, there's such security here. Your status as one of God's children does not rest on your performance, but on his mercy. You obey God not to earn his mercy, but because of his mercy. So have you got the mercy of God clear in your heart? Or has it become mundane to you? Isn't it true that often as we go through life, the mercy of God loses its sparkle? It becomes commonplace. We sometimes sing a song that says, "May I never lose the wonder of your mercy." It's a great kind of, it's a great aspiration, but it's pretty unreasonable. I lose the wonder of God's mercy. Where's it gone? What have I done with it? I've lost the wonder. I've lost the wonder. Well, don't panic. If you've lost the wonder of God's mercy, if it's become mundane, don't panic. But re-engage your heart. Ask that God would show you again his mercy. I beg of you, please don't settle for a mundane view of God's mercy. Don't settle there. Pursue wonder. Here's what we should be getting on with. The first thing we should be getting on with, treasuring God's mercy. And as we see how much he's loved us and how much he's given us, then these two great commands flow out from there. The first, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. The second, be transformed. So let's think together about this idea of being a living sacrifice. As soon as you hear the language of sacrifice, you should immediately be thinking of temple and priests and altars and offerings. That is, you should be thinking of worship. We're in the realm of worship when we talk about this language of sacrifice. The mercy of God leads us to worship him. But when I talk about worship, I mean worship in the biggest possible sense of that word. Not a narrow little worship, but a maximum worship. So let's think back to the temple. What was temple worship like in the days before Jesus? Well, sacrifice played a key part. I've been reading through Leviticus this week in my morning Bible readings. I try to read the Bible every day, and this week it was in Leviticus. And sacrifice is everywhere. There are burnt offerings and grain offerings and fellowship offerings and guilt offerings and sin offerings. They go on and on because sacrifice, this idea of offering, is fundamental to temple worship. Now, some of those sacrifices were to deal with sin. The guilt offering was to make atonement for the wrong that the people had done. But some of the sacrifices were to express devotion and dependence to God, a thankfulness to God for all that he had given. But in every case, the sacrifices were costly and they were burned on the altar. And you get this repeated idea in Leviticus that the aroma, the smell of the offerings on the altar was pleasing to God. The picture is that as the people worship with their sacrifices, God in heaven smells the aroma and he is pleased. But you offer the best. You don't give God the leftovers. You don't bring a scrawny lamb with a dodgy front leg. No, you brought the best. The people are repeatedly told, you must bring a lamb without defect. You must bring an offering that is from the first fruits. It's got to be the best. It's funny, isn't it, how human nature never really changes. We all have this sort of attitude that sometimes wants to work out, well, what can I get away with? What's the least I can bring? But that's to treat worship like a box of celebrations. You know, the chocolates. You know, that's like taking out all of the Maltesers' teasers out of the box before you then offer them to your guests. I mean, we've never done that, honestly. But God is not some unwanted guest that you have to grudgingly share your chocolate with. He's the God of all glory who calls people to worship him. You bring the Maltesers' teasers to him as the first fruits, as the best. And the temple worship was to teach the people, you worship God with sacrifice. But the sacrifices of the temple, they were never the final plan. They were a pattern of worship. They were to teach the people about worship, but they were never the full reality of worship. They were always pointing forwards to something more. Now, the reality of worship is not seen until Jesus comes. And when Jesus comes, he is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Remember, some of the sacrifices dealt with sin and made atonement. Jesus offers that sacrifice on our behalf. Jesus offers the best. He offers everything. The spotless Lamb of God, the perfect Son of God, goes to a cross to die in our place. He offers the sacrifice. There are no more sacrifices for sin. There is no more atonement left to be made. But there is still a sacrifice of worship to be offered. Not the sin offering, but now the offering of devotion and dependence. That's what Paul is talking about when he talks about the living sacrifice that we now offer. So we offer the whole of our lives as a sacrifice to God. We are to offer, verse 1 says, our bodies as a living sacrifice. That is a pretty complete and total idea. Not a part of something, but everything. It helps us to see that this worship, this offering that Paul is talking about, is not some airy-fairy spiritual thing. It's real. It's flesh. We place ourselves on the altar as an offering before God. We no longer bring an offering. Instead, we are the offering. This vision of worship is so deeply challenging. And it's massive, isn't it? We aren't talking about a bit of singing on Sundays. There we go, that's worship done. We're talking about everything. You don't give God the leftovers. You don't give God what's left over after your busy week. You don't take out all the Maltesers and give God the Milky Ways and the Mars bars. You give him everything, the whole box. You say, it's all yours. So just think about our bodies for a second. That includes what we do with our hands, the work that we do with our hands. Your work, offer your work as a living sacrifice. If you're more busy at the moment, offer your busyness as a living sacrifice to God. If you're less busy, offer your extra time as an offering to God. One helpful way, I think, to think about this is to remember Isaiah, who one day had an experience, a worshiping experience in the temple in Isaiah chapter 6, where he saw the glory of God and he realized he was sinful, and then atonement was made and his sin was taken away. And his response was to say, here am I, send me. That's the language of a living sacrifice. Here am I. So as you get up in the morning, you turn to God and you say, God, here am I today. Send me, use me. What will you do with me today? As you turn on your computer to do your work, here am I, Lord. As you think of your empty morning where you've got nothing to do, here am I, Lord. This morning is yours, not mine. What would you like me to do with it? We offer everything to him. Here am I. As you put the key in the door at the end of the day and you walk into your flat and you see your housemates, you walk in saying, "Here am I, Lord. Let me be a living sacrifice to you with these people." As you think about your bigger dreams and ambitions, we have so many plans, but where's that heart of Isaiah that says, "Here am I, Lord, send me. Where do you want me to go? What do you want me to do? How do you want me to use my life? How do you want me to use my gifts? Here am I. Lord, here is my money. It's a living sacrifice. Here are my gifts. It's a living sacrifice. Here is my time. It's yours. It's all yours." Now you can hear that's scary, right? But as you do that, Paul says, it is holy and pleasing to God. So don't you ever think, "Well, why would God want me? What would God be bothered about me for?" No, God says, "I want you because you're holy. I want you because I love you. I want you because Jesus paid for your sin. You're holy to me. You're pleasing to me." And as we offer ourselves to him, it's like that aroma in the temple. It goes up to God and he smells it and he's pleased. He wants you. Now, why do we find it hard to offer our bodies as living sacrifices? Let's face it, that's not easy, right? If any of you are sitting watching that going, "Fine, okay, I'll do that." Hopefully most of us are saying, "That's a massive thing." I think here's three reasons why I think it's hard to offer your body as a living sacrifice. First, because I think we by nature play it safe. We don't like to do things that are risky. And being a sacrifice is not safe. I mean, ask Fluffy the lamb. To be a sacrifice is costly. To be a sacrifice is going to hurt. To be a sacrifice is going to mean that you give stuff up. And that doesn't feel very safe. And so we're like a tightrope walker who says, "Fine, I'll walk the tightrope as long as I've got a safety harness." And we always want to have a safety harness. And God says, "No, forget the safety harness. Entrust yourself to me. Be a living sacrifice. Offer everything to me." You say, "I can't." Well, look at God's mercy. In view of his mercy. So some of us need to take more risks as a living sacrifice. Secondly, I think we find it hard because by nature we have a volunteer mentality. That is that I'm sort of, being a Christian means I sort of volunteer for God's team. And when we serve God, we act as if we're doing him a favor. Isn't God lucky that I was willing to help out today? Now, the great thing about being a volunteer is that you maintain all the control. Someone phones you up and says, "Could you help out this evening?" You say, "I can't do this evening. Could I do next Tuesday?" You're a volunteer. You have all the control. And we can be like that with God. "Yeah, fine, God, I don't mind volunteering a bit of time. What would you like?" But a sacrifice is everything. And for some of us, we need to switch out of a volunteer mentality into a sacrifice. "Lord, everything, it's all yours and it's all for you." And the third reason that I think we find it hard to be living sacrifices is because we keep looking at what we've given up. Look, can I say, it's always going to be hard to live a life of sacrifice if your focus is on what you've given up. All that you've lost. All that could have been yours if you hadn't made this choice. Now that just leads to self-pity. Now the mercy of God is so compelling that we become willing to give up anything for him. So look, rather than being obsessed with what it's costing us, why don't we seek to be obsessed with the one we're giving it up for? That's what happens when the mercy of God gets a hold of our hearts. We say, "I'll give you anything. I'll do anything for you." And it's worship. That's very practical. That's what we should be getting on with today. Treasuring the mercy of God and offering our bodies as living sacrifices. And then the third thing, and the second command, is to be transformed. So this is verse 2. "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." So the mercy of God will lead us to offer our bodies as living sacrifices and to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. I think one of the great pressures of being under lockdown, I don't know if you've noticed this, is that we're all supposed to be learning new skills. We're supposed to be exercising more and transforming our lives. We're supposed to be changing ourselves. We like the idea of change, but for most of us, we're so busy, we haven't got the time to do anything. But what Paul has in mind is not the pressure to change ourselves, but rather the willingness to be transformed by God. You see, when you encounter this extraordinary mercy of God, it doesn't leave you the same. You are profoundly changed by him. So rather than being conformed to the pattern of this world, we are transformed by the word of God. Being conformed doesn't take any thought. It doesn't take any, it just happens to us. Words are spoken and we listen to them and we pick up the ideas and the values of this age. And we're conformed to be more and more like the world that we live in. But God says we need to resist that and instead be transformed. And it is the transformation of our minds that we need. Now, this really is beautiful. Transformed by the renewing of your minds. You know, back in Romans chapter 1, back at the start of this book, this is what Paul said. He said that humanity had become futile in its thinking and darkened in its understanding. Do you hear that? Futile in its thinking. And so we have minds that are dark and futile. But what God's mercy does is he transforms us and renews us. He brings life. He brings clarity. He brings color. Through the majestic mercy of God, we're made new. This makes me think, and I'm sorry if this is a silly illustration, but it always reminds me of the Lion King. In the film, The Lion King, Scar is ruling over the land. He's a bad king. And everything is dark and grey, and there's bones and death everywhere. And it's miserable. But then Simba, the rightful king, comes back to Pride Rock. And there's a battle and Scar is defeated and Simba is installed as king. And when Simba is installed as king, suddenly all the land is renewed. Suddenly there's color and there's light and there's beauty and there's water and there's life. Life under Scar was dark and futile. Life under Simba is renewed. That's what God is doing. He is transforming us, transforming our minds, transforming our thinking. By nature, our thinking is dark and futile, but God, by his mercy, transforms our thinking so that we might have life. And so the command is to be transformed. That is to allow God to transform us. That means to listen to what he says. It means that we delve into his word, that we seek to understand his word, that we seek to understand what he has to say to us, that we want to know more of this mercy, more of Jesus, more of all that God has done for us, more of what pleases him. Because as our mind is transformed, then, end of verse 2, you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. So as your mind is transformed by God, suddenly you begin to know what is right. You begin to love what God loves. You begin to desire the things that God desires. You see, this is why Christianity is never going to be a list of rules that you have to obey. Here is a list of rules that you have to keep. That's man-made religion. I've got all these desires that are wrong, but there's some rules that try and keep me straight. But the The mercy of God is so much bigger and so much better than that, because the mercy of God comes into our dark and futile minds and changes our desires. It changes our thinking. So that we no longer need a list of rules to tell us what to do. Instead, we begin to understand the very heart of God and love and desire the things that he loves. So what should we be getting on with today? We'll get on with being transformed. Get on with asking that God would fill your mind with a knowledge of his will so that you can live in this way that pleases him. Be aware of the patterns that we are conforming ourselves to and ask that he would transform us. So that's where we're starting. That's what we should be getting on with today. Treasure the mercy of God. Like, delight in his mercy. Offer your body as a living sacrifice, whole, complete, costly, risky. And be transformed. Allow God to renew your thinking so that you begin to love like he loves. Why don't we pray together and ask that God would help us to obey these commands? Father, thank you so much that before you give us commands, you give us some motivation. Thank you that our obedience flows from your mercy. And Lord, we pray that we would know that to be real in our lives. Father, we're so sorry when your mercy becomes mundane. Father, please might your mercy sparkle in its beauty in our eyes. And we pray that we would, in response to your mercy, offer our bodies as living sacrifices, and that we would have our minds renewed as we listen to your word and as you change us. Lord, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Joe's going to lead us in a time of singing where we'll have a chance just to reflect and respond. Perhaps there are areas where God has challenged you this afternoon. Perhaps you long for a deeper understanding of mercy. Or perhaps you know there are areas where you're holding things back. Perhaps you want to be transformed more and more. Let's use this time to respond to God and ask him to be at work in us.
Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. We're going to sing together. We're going to ask that God would help us to keep that mercy in our view. Lord, thank you for all that you've done for us. Our response is because you have acted so mercifully towards us. Help us to see in greater depth what it means that you washed away our sin, that you gave us riches we could never have earned or deserved. Sing what love could remember.
What love could remember, no wrongs we have done. Omniscient or knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. His mercy is more. stronger than darkness. New every morn, our sins they are many, His mercy is more. Of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood beneath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord. His mercy is more, stronger than darkness. New every morn, our sins they are many. His mercy is more.
Lord, where we ought to be debtors, Your mercy makes us rich. How could we not offer You our lives in response? Lord, we pray that though our hearts may be cold, though we may miss gathering together today, though it might be hard to concentrate, hard to feel the weight of what You've done, we ask that Your mercy would be real to us. Give us a fresh sense of what the blood of Christ means for us. Lord, we need You. We need You to transform us. We need Your Spirit to work in us. Lord, where we are cold, would You fan into flame a desire to honor You, a desire to be holy and live a life that honors You. Lord, even now, as we sit in our own homes, I pray that You would place things on our hearts, ways in which we can honor You, ways in which we can offer ourselves to You, even this week. And Lord, transform us that we might actually live those lives of worship to You. Not thinking that worshiping You is about singing a song on a Sunday and then forgetting You, but instead seeking to honor You with every breath, with every action, with every word we speak. All because of what You've done for us. Let's sing What Gift of Grace.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Great. Well, we've heard God's word and we've been able to sing together and to think about that mercy, which is so precious to us and motivates us in our obedience. And what I want us to do now is just spend some time thinking about what that might look like in practice. And we're going to have a Zoom call. We're going to try this, a Zoom call with three other people from church where we're going to try and discuss what we've just heard in the sermon. And try and apply it a little bit more, think about what it might look like in specific places. So I'm going to turn this camera around like this. And on the Zoom call here, we've got Charlie and Esther and Nicola. Charlie, why don't you just say hello, say who you are.
Hi, I'm Charlie. I'm a student who studies music and I'm currently isolating in Southampton.
Great. Charlie, it is great to see you. Nicola?
Hi, I'm Nicola. I'm still in London with my husband Ewan, and I'm a civil servant.
Fab. And Esther?
Hi, everyone. My name's Esther. I am also in London with my husband, and I am also a civil servant.
Great.
A lot of diversity here.
So guys, you've listened to Romans 12, you've listened to God's word, and it'd be great to think what difference does it make? What are the things that God's been saying particularly to you, and how do you think that should challenge us as a church family? Who wants to kick us off?
Yeah, I can start.
Great, Charlie, go for it. What were you thinking about?
I guess I was really struck by how much I think about the cost of sacrifice rather than thinking about it as an act of worship. So in particular, thinking about, you know, what I'm missing out on, what it feels like the rest of the world has that I don't. So maybe particularly the idol of success for me and, you know, wanting to kind of, you know, be a successful musician or whatever. And yeah, sometimes it feels really hard to give that up and to sacrifice some of that work for worshiping God, for making God my the thing that I long for and delight over.
Yeah, sure. So what are some of the ways you could begin to think about countering that? In some ways we can see where we have issues around these things, but how could we begin to move forward?
Yeah, I was thinking about how, you know, when we're spending time reading the Bible and praying, it doesn't feel like we're kind of achieving anything. You know, we're not earning ourselves any status with God, because it's all because of his mercy, as we saw. And so how, when we're doing that, when we're spending time with God, we're saying no to the world, we're not conforming to its pattern, and we're saying, you know, actually this isn't about getting something done, it's about putting ourselves in God's hands and saying, you know, I'm here because of your mercy, and I want to carry on, and I want to worship you because of your mercy.
Yeah. Cool. Nicola, why don't you share some of your thoughts? What are you thinking?
I was really struck by the section on offering our bodies as a living sacrifice, and particularly about giving God our best and our all, like our whole body. I think so often, if I'm honest, I give God our leftovers, my leftovers, sorry. So I suppose I was thinking about this particularly in relation to my career. I'm fortunate to have a secure job with a decent salary, and I was thinking, would I be willing to give that up for God? And even if I were, would I think more about what I'd given up than who I'd given it up for?
How do we begin to find joy even in? I'm just quite struck by the danger is that it can become quite negative. It can become quite, I need to give this up. And how do we switch that so we begin to find some joy in obedience? And I think, Nicola, you've had an experience recently, haven't you, of kind of having time off work forced. How's that kind of made you think differently about work? And
yeah. So over the past few weeks, I've not been working, developed a repetitive strain injury with my arms, the joys of working from home. And so because of that, I've been forced to not work. And I think it's really made me recognise just how much I value work, how much I put my identity in my work. Mm. And it's been really good in some ways. I've had more opportunity to rest, do things I wouldn't normally do. I've had more time to spend with God, which has been great. But I think it has really made me realise how much I put on my work, how much importance I give to my work. And really, the whole thing needs to be flipped around. You know, my whole life should be a living sacrifice to God, which includes my work. But it's not just my work, and I should be doing my work for God. So I think if I'm ever at a point where I wouldn't be willing to give up my work or, you know, move to a different job with a lower salary, so that I could better use my time, my gifts for God. There's probably something wrong there. And I think it's something I'm regularly challenged by. I'm generally fairly ambitious and the work is important to me. Work is good, but it shouldn't be everything.
Yeah, and that's it is a fine line, isn't it? That kind of, it's good to work. It's not that it's good to have a job and it's good to work hard and it's good to have a career and it's good to be successful and to do things. But like you say, it's having that in its right place. It can often flip it into being the most important thing. How about you, Esther? Where have you found this to be a challenge?
Yeah, I think in general, just being challenged to offer everything that we have over to God and knowing that we are actually not in control. I think with this whole coronavirus pandemic, it has shed a lot of light into the areas of my life where I have not given God complete control over and thinking that I am ultimately in the driver's seat. So yeah, it has been a challenge, especially on the sort of, say, for instance, on my visa front. I thought that I would be able to plan months ahead to make sure that I get that visa extension, but coronavirus happened, and that threw a curveball in terms of my whole application process, and even things that we think we would be able to rely on, right? The sort of like bureaucratic processes that government has, you know, all of that could be taken away by God instantaneously. And so I think it's really a challenge for me to, you know, examine areas of my life where I haven't given enough sort of prayer and acknowledgement that God is in control.
Yeah, it's so helpful. And I think, do you think that we miss out on joy because we hold stuff back? Do you see what I mean? So we feel like if we were to sacrifice everything for God, it would be too hard and we'd miss out on a whole load of joy. But actually, we're missing out on the joy of really serving him. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, 100%. I think definitely we think that, you know, our way is the best way in order to obtain our happiness. But in reality, when we actually, you know, give it over to God and just submit to him and say, look, you know, all these areas of my life, even though I think I have the best plan, I don't, you know, my sort of knowledge is so infinite, like so small in comparison to God's knowledge and his plans, right? And, you know, I can just think of a million ways in which I've been challenged, you know, on the financial front, for instance, right? Like how, you know, despite especially the pressures that we have now around coronavirus, right? People are getting furloughed. People are, you know, obviously under tons of financial strains. You know, it's, again, a challenge for us to say, look, have we really sort of given this area of our lives over to the Lord, right?
So just as we kind of wrap this up a little bit, Charlie, how would you love us to pray that this will make a difference in your life? And as you think about your life, it might help others to think, oh, I could pray that for me as well. How would you love it to change you?
Yeah, I guess the entirety of those two verses are a great prayer in themselves, that we would be, transformed and renewed. I guess this week especially, I would love my mind to be renewed so that what I desire, what I chase after is not what the world offers, but what God offers in his mercy.
Yeah, brilliant. And I think just as we sit here and we're kind of a representative of our church family, there's only four of us, but we're representing our whole church family. You know, I think it would be great for us as a church family to be praying these things for each other, to be praying that the mercy of God would so motivate us that we would obey him joyfully, giving anything and everything that he calls us to, being transformed by him. Guys, thank you so much for sharing your thoughts and your ideas on this passage. It's been really helpful. And I wonder, Nicola, you're going to lead us in prayer. Why don't we pray together as a church family? Thanks, Nicola.
Great, let's pray. God, we thank you that you are unchanging. And we thank you that our status before you is also unchanging. We are still made right with you because of your mercy. despite all the changes we're facing at the moment. And I pray that you'd help us to get on with our lives despite all the challenges that we're facing. You'd help us to get on with treasuring your mercy, that we would offer our bodies as sacrifices to you, and that you would be transforming us so that we can better discern what you want from us, better discern your will. Father, I pray for wisdom as to how you want us to use our time and our gifts at the moment, particularly for people whose circumstances have changed, for people who have lost jobs or been furloughed, for people who are living in a different place to normal. I pray that you'd help all of us, whether we have more time or less time, whether our circumstances are better or worse, you'd help us to be offering our lives as a living sacrifice to you that's holy and pleasing to you. And Father, I want to pray particularly for our church family. I pray that you'd help us to keep connected to one another and connected to you during this time. You'd help us to love one another well. I pray for focus groups, that they would provide community for people and that we'd be able to be supporting one another. And I pray for those who aren't in focus groups as well, for people who are newer to the church, people who are tuning in to Globe for the first time, that we'd be able to find ways to bring people into the church family and make them feel welcome. And Father, we also think of Equitil, our partner church in France. Pray for them as they also adjust to new ways of meeting. Pray that they would care for each other well, and that they would be good witnesses for you, and that they would present the hope that they have in Jesus to their friends and neighbours. Thank you for the webinar that they did recently on the evidence for the resurrection. And Father, I pray that you would use that session to bring people closer to knowing you, and that it would be really helpful to resolve some people's questions about the resurrection. And we pray for our brothers and sisters in France who have health needs, those who are having to self-isolate completely. Pray that they would still feel part of the church and that they would be able to hold on to the hope that we have in Jesus. And Father, looking back to our nation, we pray for our leaders with all the difficult decisions they have to make. We pray for Boris Johnson, Matt Hancock and their advisors, that they'd be making wise choices that protect the poor and the vulnerable. And Father, I pray that you would be guiding them. We pray for Christians who are in politics and in government, that you would be giving them wisdom and helping to serve you, giving their whole lives as living sacrifices to you. And we think about the economic impact of coronavirus as well, Father. And in these really difficult circumstances, we pray that people will be turning to you, calling out to you for help. And we remember how Jesus cared for the poor and the vulnerable when he was on earth. And Father, we pray that you would be providing. And we pray for organisations who are helping people in need, that you would give them the resources that they need to help others. And for Christians working there, I pray that they would be bringing hope to people in difficult situations. And as we look to the impact of COVID-19 in other nations, Father, we think about countries where people were already living in terrible situations before the virus, and countries that have been hit by war and famine and political unrest. And sometimes it's hard to even know what to pray because there are so many, there's so much need, there's so many things to be praying for. We pray particularly for Yemen, Father, where there's been war for a long time and so much of their infrastructure has been destroyed, more than half of their hospitals. And with so many people dependent on aid to survive, Father, I pray that you would have compassion, that you would stop the spread of the virus there. I pray that you'd be giving NGOs everything they need to provide food and aid for people, that you would be securing their funding. Thank you, Father, that you hear our prayers. Thank you that you love it when we come and talk to you. And we praise you because you are a powerful God. You are our creator God. And we trust that you have power to transform situations even when we feel so powerless. Amen.
Amen. Guys, thank you so much. That's brilliant. I will hope to see you again soon. And we're going to take some time now to finish our service by singing together. And I really want to encourage you that
just as we've been talking, that we each would consider together what it is that God would call us to change. What would you love God to change in your life? That the mercy of God would motivate you to live differently this week as a living sacrifice, being transformed by God. Well, we're going to sing together, "Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God." We're going to sing of his mercy, of all that he's done for us. And as we sing this song, let's ask that he would be transforming us to be more like him.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, oh Lord. O Lord our God. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. O trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, oh Lord, oh Lord.
Great. Well, that brings us to the end of our time together this afternoon. I really miss you guys. I really miss being able to sing with you and see you. But I hope that as we've looked at God's word this afternoon, it's encouraged us. Let's keep treasuring the mercy of God. Let's keep encouraging one another. Let's keep meeting up with one another online. Let's be committed to one another and committed to focus groups. If you're in a focus group, then please keep meeting and keep praying for each other in the light of all that we've seen today. And let me particularly highlight tomorrow evening, Monday evening, 7 o'clock, we have our Globe Connect course. I'm very excited about this. We ran a trial of it last week just to make sure it all worked smoothly. 15-minute talk, then a chance for questions and a bit of discussion. And looking at this subject of who is God and how do we know what God is like, and really trying to engage with some of those things. So if you've got friends who'd be interested in that, or perhaps you'd be interested in that, please do join us. The link for the Zoom meeting will be in the weekly email, which will come out tomorrow. It was also in last week's email. So please send that link to your friends. Invite people to come. Have a go. Just invite people. See what happens. And let's pray that God would use tomorrow night to introduce others to the good news of Jesus. But thank you for joining with us today. And why don't we bow our heads and pray as we finish. Therefore, in view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as living sacrifices. Father, please would we treasure your mercy this week, and would that mercy compel us to offer everything to you. Lord, help us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you. Have a great week, and I look forward to seeing you soon.